What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the O'Shea Vlogcast. I'm your host, O'Shea Duke Jackson. Today, I have the privilege and the honor of a distinguished guest, a guy I actually have watched on Facebook for many years and didn't even know like he was even watching me. But my man, Eric Stanley, the contemporary violinist and also classically play that too. Welcome to the channel, man. Glad to have you here. A lot of brothers was excited about you coming. What's going on, man?
What's good? What's good? I'm excited to be here too, man. This is definitely I don't do a lot of interviews. You know what I mean? I don't do a lot of I'm actually pretty private. So I just want to share with the young black brothers here today. And hopefully you guys can get some insight just from like my life and my journey.
Okay, yeah, man. Shit, I'm glad to have your superstar ass on here, man. I ain't nobody, man. You've been everywhere. So, shit, you know, we're glad to have you over here. We call this the hood of YouTube. So, we glad to have you. Get a 40 and some chicken strips, man. And come in. So welcome to everybody coming into the chat. Let me ask you this, Eric. You know, I know you talked about it briefly. You joined the hangout that we had the other night. But you talked about, you know, your journey. Let's not even talk about the violin. Let's just talk about you as a person. Kind of like how you grew up, how you came up as a young black man in Virginia, and then we can kind of build on that, and we can move to the violin later. But let's talk about who you are and some of the experiences as a kid you had, how you grew up.
I grew up in Chesapeake, 757 area, and I was always like a quiet kid. You know, I didn't really, I wasn't around too many people. I stayed to myself for the most part. And I moved to Richmond when I was fairly young. And I had two different sides of my life. One was like around predominantly black people. And then the other side was around all white people. And I started violin when I moved to Richmond. And I was around a lot of white people. And it was tough because obviously I stood out. But It was crazy because I got to see two sides. When I moved to Richmond, it was real tough playing violin. I got teased a lot. And people made fun, man. They were just clowning, you know. And they made all types of jokes, like black kids don't play violin. Your skin is dirty. You are never going to be good. And I went to a lot of camps and stuff, you know, like a lot of like, violin camps, and they said the same stuff. I went to a camp in Bethesda, Maryland, and I got some of the most hate I've ever gotten in my life. But I started to see that playing violin as a black man, it was a threat to them. And at the time, I was just trying to play music, you know, and I still to this day just trying to give something back to people, man, just to help them.
Let me ask you this, because you said it's a threat to people. I want to make sure I get this right. It was just black people who were seeing your skins dirty, or was this actual white people?
This was white people. And it was tough to try to, I guess, like, I think now in my hometown, I get a lot of respect now because they see that I pushed through. I kept going. Even I was getting clowned by everybody. People were like, oh, you're still playing violin. Why are you doing that? Like, that's not going to make you any money. And I think just going, the fact that I kept going was like, oh snap, he was serious about this. Oh, he's really serious. Like next month, I'm gonna be with Usher in Atlanta. Like, I'm not playing with this. You know, I'm really serious about violin and inspiring people. So it's definitely the whole point of playing is just to show people like, not that they want to play violin. I'm not trying to get people to play violin per se. I just want them to keep going at what they're doing. Everybody has something they're good at. You know what I mean?
So let's do this. In Richmond, it was hard to play the violin. I know that you had some heat from white people, but I gotta be honest, man. Yeah. When I saw you on Facebook a few years ago, it wasn't that I was shocked that a black male could like take a typical, what is called a classical musical instrument like the violin, and flip it. I wasn't shocked that you could play that good. I was shocked that a nigga was, I mean, not to call you a nigga, but a black man, but you know, we in here. Niggas was violent. I was like, I'll bet you a black church. Yeah. Drums, boom, da, boom, da, boom, da, boom. Yeah, niggas wanna play the organ.
Yeah.
But the violin, I'm like, we ain't got one of them at the church. You know what I'm saying? So I guess what shocked me is that you even had an interest in that.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess I want to know is how did the black people, because I know how, you know, some of the white people, and I know pretty much for the most part, I'm guessing that the majority of your fans, at least half of them, are probably white. Is that mm-hmm. true? Or?
Yes.
Okay. What about black people? What's your experience with them when you're coming up playing the violin? And how'd they take it?
I mean, they just didn't care for it. They just weren't checking for it. You know, it was like one of those things where you tell people what you do and they downplay it. You know, people size you up. And I think I didn't get support for playing the violin until after I had put my music out there on WorldStar. And until I kept putting music out there, then people were like, oh, well, he's serious about this, you know? And support in my hometown was the hardest to get, to get people to believe in what I was doing.
Mm-hmm.
That's why it's very tough when you can get support in your hometown, you can get it anywhere, really. And so I saw something I noticed and just like, just in musicians in my own, musicians really in any local market, man, it's always going to be tough trying to break out and get people to believe. As a violinist, it was extra, extra hard. You know, it's like you got to make people believe that, you know, that the violin is a serious instrument and it's on the same level as the music that you hear on the radio, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, before I go to the WorldStar video.
Mm-hmm.
And shout out to everybody that's coming in the chat. Please make sure you guys like the video. Shout out to my man Julian Brown, always supporting with the Fire Art Super Chat. Let me talk to about, because you know, you went to Virginia Commonwealth.
Mm-hmm.
Virginia Commonwealth as of late. I don't know about last year, the year before, but I know in the last 10 years they've been making some noise as far as basketball school. Now, obviously, Virginia Commonwealth, it's a great institution. They have a medical school there, mm-hmm. one of the best schools in the state of Virginia. Everybody knows about VCU and some of the educational achievements that they have there, but many people don't know that you are also an athlete. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about your love for sports.
All through middle and high school, I love playing basketball. Basketball was one of my passions, man. I just enjoyed it. I enjoyed the game, but I just didn't have the love for it. When I got to college, and I was really like going hard at basketball, I was going to try to walk on to the team, and I just hit a point in my life where a lot of stuff from my past that came up, and I just really like crumbled, you know, spiritually, mentally. And I remember I still had my violin. I was in the music program, and I was like, you know, I remember my violin just sitting there in the corner of the room. I was like, you know, I think I can go hard at this. I think I can really try at this. And I remember that day, man, because I was in tears, man. I was like, yeah, I don't think I'm gonna be good at anything, right? Because I remember all the negative noise from from when I was younger, like, you know, you're only gonna be good if you can do, you know, play ball or you know. You know, do this or that. And I just remember the feeling of just enjoyment when I played violin, man. It's like, it's no other feeling. Like when you know what you're supposed to be doing and how that's going to have an impact on other people in their lives, you know? And so athletes, I took the same mentality that I had with playing basketball and just translated it to the violin. Mm-hmm. That's all I did. Work hard every day at it. You know, basketball is just it's a mental game more than anything. And so is music. The music industry is a mental game. Yeah.
let me talk to you about this because you mentioned the basketball thing, and you really focused on that same work ethic onto the violin. Let's talk about how that work ethic changed your life. Before we get to the world star, but just to doing the same thing every day, what was your schedule like? Because people probably want to know, like, you know, what did you, you know, you do have the talent, but, you know, what was your ethic like? What was your day in and day out approach to what you were trying to do?
Making sure that I practice my violin, but more importantly, making sure that I'm playing out, you know, I'm doing shows, making sure that I'm doing real musician things. And so that what are real musician things look like? Real musician things, practicing, making sure you set aside hours during the day, making sure that I'm putting some music out every week, something. Not worrying about whether people are going to say it's good or it's bad, you know. And I think doing that day in and day out, you can never lose from being too consistent. You really can't. And
say that again.
you can never lose from being too consistent. Mm-hmm. There's no way you can lose. And so that's why a lot of people are frustrated with you know, who are doing music, they're frustrated with it because they're like, oh, so this person over here, you know, they're not good, but why are they on the BET Awards? Or why are they over here? Why are they getting Grammys? Well, they're consistent. And I took that consistency. I took like little bits and pieces from the people around my life. Everybody has something they could teach you. And I got a journal. I started writing down things I could do to better myself. And before I was like around 2009 when I started, I was worrying about, oh, how can I be the best violinist? I got to be better than everybody else. You know, I was trying to be the best in my orchestra. And it didn't work. It's like I always would hit a ceiling. It's like, okay, what's next? And until I started bettering myself, I always found myself improving. Not just at playing a violin, but being a better person, like just being a better man, like taking care of my own business, you know, doing the things I need to do. And I've made a video every single day on YouTube. A lot of my videos got deleted because my channel was hacked. Mm-hmm. But I made a video every single week. I don't care what happened. A video every single week. And so what happens is all that compounded interest of work over the years has got me to where I am right now, which is doing music full time. Mm-hmm. And I remember the day I started taking music more seriously. I went and performed an open for Bill Clinton back in 2012.
Wow, Bill Clinton.
And it was in Orlando in Disney World. It was like a learning conference. And I saw that I was a professional musician. I'm like, I'm getting paid for this. I'm a professional musician. I'm still in college. I'm like, I don't understand this. This doesn't make sense. Why am I in music school right now and I'm already a professional musician? I'm looking at my peers. Nobody else is performing out here. And I remember one of my teachers in college, she was like, I told her I'm performing for Bill Clinton in Orlando. I won't be able to come to class. She was like, well, you're going to get a zero. And she didn't even let me like come with any like options to get a grade still. Like I could have did some extra work or whatnot. I remember that at that moment, I switched out of the music program. I changed degrees immediately. I was like, this doesn't make sense to be at a music school right now. So I went and switched my degree towards interdisciplinary studies. And so what basically that's, you can make your own, you can set your own classes, right? And I like that because I was able to pick what I wanted to do, take the classes I wanted to take, and it made sense. I wasn't taking any like just dumb classes, right? like electives that I did that don't help me at all. I was taking classes towards like music industry, entrepreneurship. And that's when I started to think about how many different avenues there are for musicians other than shows, you know, just making money from shows and stuff. Yeah.
Let me ask you this. And I'm going to go back to something you said previously, and shout out to Laquan Jones for the super chat. He said, I did a video. He said, he liked it, but thank you for that, man. Appreciate you. I want to go back to something that you said, because I noticed as a successful person like you, you have a journal. And you would write in this journal things that you needed to work on.
Yeah.
Okay, let's stop right here, because I think this is very important for people who are very successful. You understand that something about me is fucked up in this particular department. You own it. You realize it. And you say, I need to be accountable for my shortcomings to improve. Now, let me ask you this. I hate to say this, man, and this is not to be racist against our own people. A lot of us as Black people, we don't like accountability.
Oh, of course not.
We don't like it. but the Black people who tend to do very well are those that are accountable. Now, when did you start to accept, you know, like, was it your parents taught you that? I mean, how did you learn that you needed to be accountable for your shortcomings in order to become successful? How did you figure that out? Because a lot of Black men don't understand that.
Oh, wow. That's a good question. It's a good question, actually. You always hit the good questions. Well, my mother and father divorced at an early age. I was about 4. And you know, it's easy to blame your parents on where you are right now. And I had to reach that point where it's like, it's not my father's fault. It's not my mother's fault. They messed up. But what I can change is how I go from this day forward, right?
Say that again. Say that again.
It's not my mother or my parents' fault. Uh-huh. My father's fault. They were messed up. They had their problems. I can't change that, but what I can change is how I continue right now in this moment, like how I continue. And I think that's one of those big hurdles that everybody has to get over, the things that happened in their childhood, you know, the stuff that nobody wants to talk about, you know, those painful moments, man. It's like people just want to act like they are, like, it doesn't matter. I'm okay. I don't care what my dad did. But you have to address those things. Until you address it, you're always going to be messed up. You're always going to feel broken. You're always going to feel lost. And it took me to having a relationship with my father again, because I hadn't seen him for 10 years. That's when I started to grow. That's when my impact as a violinist started to have a significant impact on others.
Stop right there.
Yeah.
I mean, stop you, but I mean, I got to, because you said you didn't see your dad for 10 years.
10 years, yep.
When you reconnected with your dad.
Yeah.
That is when the violin, your career started to blow.
Yes.
The reason why I want to know is because a lot of us, as you know, in Black communities, many of us have been disconnected from our fathers, or have some kind of beef with our dads due to whatever mom told us about dad or something like that. But can you tell us why the reconnection?
Oh, the reconnection. Okay, I'll tell you what why I wanted to reconnect. My brother, he had just got off of drugs from heroin. He was hooked on heroin for a number of years. And my brother had graduated this program in Richmond, Virginia. It was a Christian-based program for, you know, just getting off drugs and getting your life together. And I invited my dad out to come to his graduation. We held it at the church. Mm-hmm. And my dad was there. My brother looked at my father, and my brother walked out. But he was sober. He got sober from heroin. He was sober for like a year. And I saw my brother walk out, man. He was like, he was hurt because he hadn't seen him in a not long time too. And they just had a lot of stuff, you know, resentment. And I said, yo, I got to get my brother. I got to get my brother and my father in the same room. They got to talk about this because he's just going to go back to the same old patterns with the drugs. That's a key part that he needs to fix. And more so, I wanted to reconnect just for my brother too, man. Like, I wasn't doing it for myself, but for my whole family. And we sat down, grilled some steaks, you know what I mean? We talked it over. I knew from that moment on, man, like, my brother was going to be cool. Like, he didn't have to worry about falling back in the traps of heroin, you know?
Well, let me ask you this. Once you and your brother and your dad got together, how did, like, what developed in your dad's relationship with you and him personally? Like, how did that inspire you?
It's like, I think, you know, it helped me realize, like, yo, we're not going to be here forever. Like, I'd rather reconnect now while I got the time. And I just started to appreciate the time spent. I started to appreciate the time spent together, even if it was like one Friday night or something. You know, I head down to the beach, Virginia Beach, just to check up on him. Like, hey, what's going on? And it's, you know, he does the same, man. But we realized, like, yo, all the stuff that happened in the past, let's not worry about that. Let's focus on what we can do in the future. You know, let's focus on what we can do now, man. And for me, man, it helped all my relationships, every single relationship.
Let me ask you this. Did your dad started giving you, you know, certain advice? Maybe that helped you? Did he kind of step in and kind of mentor you in a little bit of the right direction?
Yeah, man. Of course, man. I just take advice. I take advice from everybody. Uh-huh. But it's helped me just to see, like, I looked at his situation. I started to see how he's not perfect. You know, it's easy to think like your parents know everything. You know what I mean? Like, they can't mess up. Shoot, he messed up. Everybody mess up. Mm-hmm. That's what I had to realize. Like, yo, we're not perfect out here. And one thing that really helped me was that reconnection. I started to see, like, yo, everybody messing up out here, man. Don't nobody got it straight. But we're, as long as, like, you're continuing to grow, you can't lose. You really can't.
Let me talk to you about this. You reconnect with your dad. You are playing the violin. You're practicing. You're consistent with your uploads on YouTube. And then I don't know. Well, actually, before YouTube was the World Star, right?
Yes.
Let's backtrack.
Yeah. All right.
You're practicing every day. YouTube comes after the World Star.
Mm-hmm.
You decide to let me get my video on World Star. Let's stop right there. Mm-hmm. Because you talked about the last time that you came onto the channel, you said, well, you know, World Star, they have a pretty interesting crowd over there.
Yeah.
A lot of crazy niggas. A shout out to World Star here, even though I don't necessarily like World Star hip hop for many reasons, but for some things about them that they do, like what you did, I do like. Not all of what they do is bad, just the majority of the shit. But
yeah.
Over there. How did you even, let's start before the video. How did you even get your video on World Star?
Well, I reached out to Q. You know, he passed away this year. Q was the owner and the founder of World Star. So I just emailed him, you know what I'm saying? Like, yo, you know, what can I do to, you know, increase my business? Just random stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I started, you know, I of course had to plug the violin, and I was like, yeah, I play violin, you know what I'm saying? And maybe I can record something. He gave me some ideas, some songs. He gave me like the clips. He said, you should do this song, the clips. I'm good. And I was like, oh, shoot, I'm a big clips fan, you know, VA. And I recorded it, man. I remember that first video. Y'all can probably find it if you go type in clips, I'm good, Eric Stanley on Google, y'all find it. That's my first video, and I remember how he talked about Q, the owner. He wanted to have some positive stuff up there, something highlighting, black excellence. And of course, WorldStar wasn't all bad. There was some good parts in there, and that's why I respect it. I still respect Q. You know, rest in peace, man. Like, I probably wouldn't be having this interview right now if it wasn't for him really continuing to push me. Because I remember I'd put a video up and I'd be like, yo, them comments, man, they slamming me like that. And he would email me back like a week later, be like, yo, you got to put up another video. I think you should do this Eminem song, you know. And I remember that, you know, that push to keep going. Because I got to remember, I was still in college. I'm still playing classical music. And I'm already discouraged on top of that. And so I'm like, I don't want to play anything.
Yeah. How many views did your first video on WorldStar get?
I think it was like maybe 30,000. 30,000 okay. Views, yeah.
And he didn't charge you? Like, it was for free?
Nah, he didn't charge me. Okay. Didn't charge me. Mm-mm.
Okay, didn't charge you. Let's talk about, so 30,000. Did you get any emails from anybody? I know they was clowning you, but like, did anybody reach out to you like, yo, man, really liked your shit? Did you have some good comments in the video at all? Or?
Oh, wow. You talking about WorldStar?
The first time. First video.
Oh, first. Oh, my goodness. It was all terrible. It was all. I first time ever seen all negative comments. Picture that. Picture all negative comments.
Yeah, I got a lot of videos of all these. I've seen them before. Okay, let's talk about the second video, because the first time, not so good.
The second one?
Yeah.
The second video. Mm-hmm. Okay, so the second video was I did a remix of Trey Songz' song called Say Ah. And that one got a little bit different response because Trey Songz shouted me out.
Really? Okay, let's talk about that. Okay, so Trey Songz, you put the video on WorldStar, right?
Calypso, Oregon. Get that Oregon out.
Calypso, Oregon. Okay, and you put it up. How many views did this video get?
It got about 300,000.
300,000. So 10 times increase. And so then this dude, Trey Songz, did Q from WorldStar like email him like, yo, check the shit out, this dude is on to something? How do you know how he got the video?
His producer, the producer of the song, actually sent it to Trey Songz. So he sent the video of me playing it to him. And okay. It's like, yo, you gotta check this guy out. And then Trey Songz posted it up, and like that really catapulted it everywhere. And I think, he really gave me a bump, man. He highlighting, you know, music in the Black community is really important. It's important to support your people in your hometown. You know, support, go out to shows, check them out. And if they're good, you know, shout them out.
Mm-hmm. True. So let me do this because, now, after this particular video, Trey Songz shouted you out. Did you ever get a chance to talk to him on email, anything like that? Or,
I mean, I didn't see him until like years later. You know what I mean? And I recently saw him in Richmond, and I remember talking to him. I was like, yo, I appreciate, you know, you helped me back then, because I remember I needed every single ounce of inspiration, because I was always like this close to giving up, to quitting. And I just said, man, thank you for that, man. I appreciate it. Mm-hmm. That was it. I wasn't trying to work with them, trying to get a song out or anything. It's just a, yo, thanks. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So now, you know, got a little bit more confidence at this point. Was there another video on WorldStar that you put up?
I put about like at least like maybe six videos up on WorldStar, six or seven.
Let's see if you remember the third time. I'm just trying to talk about it.
The third video was "Love the Way You Lie" by that song is by Eminem, and that probably had the biggest impact. And the reason that had the biggest impact is because this time Eminem talked about how I play violin. And I didn't know this. I found out about Eminem shouting me out like years later. I didn't know. And Eminem, he was going through drug addiction, pills and stuff. It's a guy, he sent me a transcript from the interview of how Eminem, he found a video from his assistant, the video I posted on WorldStar. And he said he cut the lights out in the studio and just cried, like he just broke down because he got tired of living that lifestyle, always high. And that right there let me know, like, yo, I'm on to something. I just reached Eminem, like, this is crazy. And he just shouted me out too in a radio interview. Never met him before, and I saw that impact, man. Like, if you can affect one person, you can affect millions. Because you change that one person's life, then they're going to go change other people's too. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm.
This third time, how many? So I just want to kind of give everybody the kind of incremental climb that you did, so people know that you don't get big overnight. So 30,000, second time 300,000. How many views the third time?
2 million.
Two million. Yeah. 2 million. Okay. And so did you start a YouTube channel at this time or?
I started it after I had made the clips video.
So I'm good. Which was the first one?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let's talk about this because and I'm asking some pretty distinct questions and that may require you to dig into the memory. But so let's go back to the clips. I'm good. 30,000 mm-hmm. views at the same time you start YouTube. So now you have YouTube. Now what? I saw you on Facebook. So mm-hmm. when did you start uploading videos on Facebook?
It probably like around like 2014. I didn't really use Facebook other than having a personal profile, but I always had like a business page, like a music page. I had it for a while. I'd just say some funny stuff or whatnot, but I didn't post any videos up there. Mm-hmm. I would just post on YouTube.
So you still don't post videos on Facebook?
I post a few, but for the most part, I put everything on my YouTube channel.
Okay, on YouTube. So let us talk about so you do the I'm Good on WorldStar. Let's talk about the YouTube community because WorldStar hip hop. Now I'm not trying to sound racist or anything like that, but typically people I would assume WorldStar hip hop has more of a urban community feel. So black people, white people who think they're black, white people who like to see black fuckery or underground music, a lot of rappers, right, who want to get their own music published there. Mm-hmm. it's a community. Now, YouTube is, a very, it's not black dominated. It's dominated by English-speaking white people for the most part. Okay. Yeah. Now, how did the YouTube community take your uploads?
Oh, it was very encouraging. A lot of people, it's majority of the comments were like, man, I'm inspired, man. I think I'm gonna take violin or, I'm gonna start taking singing lessons, man. I really wanna, you inspired me to pick up my instrument, young and old. I started seeing people from all over the place, man. They were just like, man, this gets me motivated, man. I wanna keep going. That's what most of the comments were. I want to do this too. I think I can do this too.
Let's talk about your climb, because you from YouTube, from your subscribers. Mm-hmm. When did you start seeing that you started getting more subscribers on YouTube?
It's always been like a slow climb.
Uh huh.
Never. It doesn't feel like it was. It's definitely been year by year, man. It's just been like the same like track, but it just keeps going. it just keeps going up. After a while, I just didn't even notice the numbers. And I looked at it, I was like, oh, snap, it's over 100,000. That's crazy. 100,000 people clicked it. Then I started to realize, like, yo, I think I'm going to go on a tour. I started last year. I was like, I quit my job. I was working at this music store. And the reason I quit my job was I went on, they had like this whiteboard up there, and they showed, they had posted like some documents, like people who had been there for the longest, right? And they had like, you know, this 20-year anniversary working here. And I remember saying, like, I was like, I don't think I'm going to be working here this long. And I was like, I just envisioned myself in the future, like working at this job, barely getting by. Mm-hmm. And this is like around like late 2015, actually. And I was like, nah, I got to quit this job. If I really want to take music seriously, I can't be at this job anymore. I love the people, man. They were cool. You know, it was a good work environment. But I knew if I really wanted to get to the next level, I can't be at this job. I got to work for myself now. You know, and, you know, I was working towards their dreams and goals at that company.
City.
So I was working towards their dreams and goals, man. Like,
I want everybody to hear that. So, like,
I used to be so tired. I was working towards the company's dreams and goals, not my own. And I remember being so tired after work. I was like, man, I'm so tired. I ain't got time to work on my stuff. I didn't want to make any YouTube videos. I don't want to do nothing. I just want to go to sleep.
And what was your job? What did you do there at the job in the first place? Like, what was your job description there?
I was a music teacher.
Mm-hmm. You're teaching the violin. And did people come in maybe like, hey man, I saw you on YouTube, or I saw you on Facebook, I saw you on Worldstar. Did you have any of those things? Like, I know you from somewhere.
Oh, I get that every single day. No matter what city I'm in, what country, I always get stopped by. Well, at least one person's like, oh man, you know, you inspired me. I think that job taught me a lot, man. Like, I was teaching young people, I was teaching old people, I was teaching all types of people. But what it made me realize is that if I want to, you know, be an entrepreneur, if I want to, all these things I wanted to be, like, you know, a successful musician, I wanted to do music full time. I couldn't do that at this job, working at this job. It was just taking up too much time.
Too much time. How much time did you, were you working there per week?
It was flexible, but it was like a 9-to-5. I was always teaching constantly every day, you know, and I saw myself, I didn't have time to work on my music. Mm-hmm. Right. I didn't have time to do like what I got to do. And when I saw that chart of people who've been there for like 20 years, 30 years, I was like, that's not going to be me. I'm not going to be working at this job for 30 years. Can't do it. I won't do it.
let's talk about, you know, you worked there for, how long did you work there for?
2 years.
2 years. Now, I'm trying to ask, how much were you making there or how much do you make now? But do you see an increase? Do you make more now than you did back then, or is there a difference? Or?
When I started working for myself, my increase, I mean, my income just skyrocketed. It was so much that I made in like doing shows and just from the internet, stuff I was doing on the internet. It was incomparable. I was like, well, it's so comfortable though. It was comfortable staying at that job. But I just never felt comfortable in the just being comfortable. It's not enough. It's like complacency, man.
Say it again. You never feel comfortable being comfortable.
Yes, I never felt comfortable being comfortable. Mm-hmm. Always like, yo, I can do more than this, man. I can do more. I know so many brothers out there who can do more. Guys who are watching right now, I know you can do more. but you're scared. You know, you're scared of what people will think, what people will say. You know, you're scared of pursuing that dream. You know, you're like, oh, I don't know if I can do it. Or you might have some time in your childhood where people made fun of you. Mm-hmm. I think you should go for it. Why not? You might not be alive tomorrow. Shoot, you might die in like 30 minutes. What are you going to do? Are you going to just be complacent? Like, are you going to be cool with working at the same spot? And you know in your heart, like, I can do more than this. Mm-hmm. And when I started writing down my goals, that's when they started to happen.
Before we get to the writing down of the goals, because I have my goals also, I'll write them down. I'm going to talk about the importance of that. Let me do this. For those people who are in the chat, I know we have 50 people watching. Do me a favor for people who are here. The video. I appreciate those of you who are coming in. And also, I want to take a time to thank Mr. Eric Stanley. I'm going to also put his YouTube channel in the chat. For those of you who want to subscribe to his channel, he has many subscribers as it is. So, but we wanted to get you over there. He's really, really interested in black male development. Wanted to talk to, I have a black male channel with mostly black people here. So do me a favor, you guys, that are here. Drubly, Bless, Abstract, James, Pro Woman, Theron. I'm putting his link in the description. Okay, I know he already has a lot of subscribers, but for those brothers who like, man, I know you from that interview, you guys are going to be, more on there to support their brother, because he's coming over here talking in black YouTube, because I got the, I ain't gonna lie, I got the ghetto YouTube sold up. You know how we do over here. We go crazy in this sector. We got our own little corner. We over here in the hood. But, a lot of times our brothers come from other places to the hood of YouTube. So you guys go, let's support him. Let's subscribe to him. All right. And do that. And if you want to ask questions to him, I'll, answer it a lot. It's an interview. It's not about me. It's about him. That's why he's here. But let me get back to the video. And like I said, if you're in the chat, like the video. The reason why, because during the playback, there are going to be thousands of people to watch this. I'm also going to put it on my main channel so that those people can see it too. Let's talk about you writing down your goals on paper. Mm-hmm. You talked about that. How did you know how to do that? Who taught you that?
I was watching a lot of videos on YouTube. And I started to see similarities. And they were like, you got to write down your goals. I started reading a lot of books too, a lot more books. And started to see the similarities with self-help books. You got to write down your goals. You got to know your goals. When I didn't have my goals down, I was all over the place. I was chasing after things that didn't help me at all. And I remember when I started writing down my goals, they seemed ridiculous at first. They were like, I would just have this kind of doubt in them. I was like, yo, this is ridiculous. I'm not going to get this. This is not going to happen. I still wrote them down anyway. And they start happening. They started happening. And then I started to see like the small growth. I knew that if I worked towards my goal every single day, whether it was playing music or making stuff for 30 minutes, it still was something. It's better than doing nothing. And so when I started writing down these goals, I mean, these things started happening. I wrote down my goals and I didn't say anything. I didn't tell people, oh, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. I'm going to get this, make this much. No, I didn't tell people anything. I just did it. I didn't go on social media like, look, guys, I'm going to do this. I'm going to go and I don't know. I didn't shout it out from the mountains. I just shut up and did it. And I feel like that's really important. That's important for for our brothers to understand, like, it's so easy to get online and say what you're going to do, to get on Facebook and be like, you know, I'm not going to be in this same position for this long, but I'm encourage you to just, if you got something that you want to do, write it down, be quiet and do it. And that's something that I still practice to this day. Like, something I want to achieve, I just be quiet and do it. Nobody has to know what I'm doing. It doesn't matter.
Let me do this, because you mentioned you never felt that it's important to tell anybody else what you need to do.
No.
Why do you think so many people, like, you know, let's be, you know, a little bit more distinct. Let me stop the show real quick. Number one, I hate to do this, but, you know, let me do this before you answer that. There are people in the chat. This interview is about Eric Stanley. I wanna make it known. I mean, this is a lot of times, like, a lot of black men don't understand. We have a guest here. A gentleman who is, you know, over 147,000 subscribers, 20 million views on his YouTube channel. There's a particular person in here asking, am I a simp for doing something else that has nothing relevant to do? Don't even delete them. Nothing even to do with this particular topic. And I told this person that's disrespectful. But the thing about it is, a lot of black men think they can just come and say whatever the fuck they want when it has nothing to do. This is a black man that we have here on the chat that is on tour across this country, on tour across the world. He's coming to talk to black men. You have one fucking idiot that's coming in here talking about something that has nothing to do. You didn't even come and look at the title or the person who we're talking about, because you want to come in here and ask some dumbass shit. All the rest of the brothers is trying to support Eric, and you have one dumb nigga. This is why a lot of niggas, that's why you can't fuck with a lot of niggas. Because you have dumbass niggas like this nigga right here. I ain't call your name, nigga, but you know what I'm talking about. Don't come in this motherfucker asking me no dumbass shit. That ain't got nothing to do with the guest. That's disrespectful shit. And you black men out there cannot think that somebody is going to respect you when you got a brother on the goddamn panel that's coming to talk to you and give you some free game. He don't have to do this. I'm going to keep it real. He ain't got to do this. I ain't got to do this. But you're going to respect the motherfucking game, the game that is being told, and you're going to respect this brother right here. Y'all not going to come here talking about that goddamn bullshit about, am I a simp because I beat up some nigga over a bitch. To ask the question is to answer it, nigga. If you got to do some dumbass shit like that, you are a fucking simp. And you're a disrespectful bitch-ass nigga. And I'm sorry for Eric fans, y'all see this shit, but you niggas gonna get it today. I'm tired of you niggas and all this fuck shit. 98% of the brothers is coming here on some real shit, trying to find out about his music, ain't heard about him, trying to tell me, oh, I heard about you. See, this is why niggas don't respect one another. And, but you ain't gonna do it here. Take that bullshit somewhere else. Back to the show. My bad. I know, Eric. I just wanted to say a few words here, buddy. Now let's talk about the we were talking about what was I talking about before I started roasting this nigga? What was I saying, Eric? Fuck me up.
Yeah, you forgot to.
Okay, listen. I think we was talking about, you know, you writing down.
Oh, yeah.
It started to happen. Now, we talked about a lot of black people feel that it's necessary for them to go tell somebody.
Oh, yeah. All right. I'll give you an example. Mm-hmm. I would tell my goals, right? And people would be like, wow, that's amazing. Congratulations. And so in my mind, subconsciously, I wouldn't do it. Because I already think it's done because people are congratulating me. And so when you tell your goals online, people will be like, oh, that's great. You know, they like it, like the post, whatever. You know, give you a few hand claps. And you won't get it done. I promise you.
Let me talk to you about this, because I'm a person that also likes to set goals but not really tell anybody. Mm-hmm. One of the hard parts about goal setting is a lot of people – don't notice your progress. You know what I mean? For example, a person that's fat and you're working out every day and you lose 10 pounds, you know, you don't notice, or people don't notice that you're, you know, losing 10 pounds. You know that you're making progress, but other people don't. But people, and it's easier for you to keep going if people are acknowledging you, you know, that you're doing something. Now, I notice when I'm setting goals and I'm making strides, but don't nobody else know it, still, sometimes it's hard to keep going because people don't notice it. You know, because sometimes as people, we like to be like, damn, oh, bro, you're Eric Stanley? Yo, man, keep doing that shit, son, that I'm good. That's my shit, nigga. But, you know, if you're practicing and you're making strides and improvements, but yeah, not nobody else know that you're making an improvement, to me, that was always hard. Talk about, like, you know, you're setting these goals, you're working on them, but nobody is telling you. Hold on a second. Let me stop the show again. Kickbox Deuce TV. You're another nigga I got to talk about. A lot of you niggas keep asking hella questions. We're doing a fucking interview. Hold on a second, Eric. I apologize. I got to check this nigga real quick. Do you mind? Let me just check these niggas. Hold on a second. You're another nigga. Let me tell you something, bro. We're doing a fucking one-on-one interview. You are not the fucking interviewer, nigga. I am. He ain't got to answer shit to your ass. He focused on what the fuck I'm asking his ass. With your stupid ass. I'm sorry, dude. You know, I got to be ghetto a little bit. Nigga, shut the fuck up. If you want to ask a question, you want me to ask a question, super chat your fucking questions. So it'll show up, nigga. Stop trying to ask somebody to ask your shit. Now, sorry about that, brother. I know this is going to be an interesting interview for your family. You're like, nigga, crazy. All right. Now let's talk about that. You know, you focusing on your goals. You're making progress. But only you know your progress. Nobody else knows it. How do you keep going forward?
You mean like, how do you like, how do you not tell people?
Well, I mean, cause sometimes, you know, like, I don't know if you have the problem, but you know you're making progress, but nobody else knows you're making it.
Oh, you wanna know, you want other people to know, right?
Yeah, that's hard because a lot of times you want, like, if you're fat and you lose like a lot of weight, you want somebody to come say, damn, man, you look good. You're like, yeah. But when you first start off, you're not, you know, you're doing the right things.
Okay, all right.
How do you keep going if you know you're making progress, but don't nobody else know? I guess that's the question I'm asking.
I try to remind myself, man, like, what I do is, it's not for me, it's just so somebody else can get inspired. That's the purpose. That's why I play violin. Mm-hmm. Because you reach a certain point where, you know, certain stuff just doesn't matter anymore. You already did it. It's like, another award show is not going to benefit me. You know, it's like, it doesn't matter. Like, the purpose is to inspire people. What I can say about that is, you know, like, I call it guess what's happening syndrome. Guess what's happening? You know, when I was going to Atlanta, man, we were in the car, my agent and my boy Brandon, we were talking about that. You know, the people that they feel they're itching. They're like, I gotta tell people what I'm doing. Gotta let them know. Oh man, they gotta know everything. And that's not a really effective approach because it's like the universe is gonna block your blessing. You're gonna block your own blessing. It's because you're telling everybody. You're trying to tell everybody what you're gonna do. So just keep it to yourself. If you keep it to yourself, it will manifest. You work towards it every day. But as soon as you start telling everybody, look, man, I'm about to make this business. I'm about to get this business. Yo, we about to get these Grammys. You know, like, if you tell everybody what you're gonna do, it's just not gonna happen.
let's get a little bit deeper into the conversation. I know you came back the other day on the panel, and I hope you know, come back, man, because you know, I know you already got a lot of fans. I mean, I know we can get you some more black ones in here because you really talked really well on that panel, man. Let's talk about your first trip overseas, because a lot of times, you know, like a, you know, educated black man like you, you know, me, I'm and I have a bachelor's in biology, and I'm now in going to my third year of medical school here. We are a few percentage of the African American men that's ever actually been outside of the United States. Many black men haven't even been outside of their own state before, sadly enough. Let's talk about your first experience doing a gig overseas. Where was it at? Let's talk about that. We're kind of gonna build on that.
My first gig overseas was in Sweden. It was in Stockholm, Sweden. Mm-hmm. And I always had my passport. I just had it. I didn't know I was gonna go anywhere. It came in time because they called me like a few weeks before, and I didn't have to scramble to get it. But I went to Stockholm, and I started to see that there's much more to this world than just, you know, Richmond, Virginia, that matter. DMV is much more to the world than just my own area. Mm-hmm. There's so much. Like, there's so much more music out there, different styles, different types of people, different types of dress, like so much stuff you can learn from just going outside. I started to see a different appreciation for music when I started traveling more. And it really helped me because that's the first time I've been in Virginia like my whole life. It's the first time I ever stepped outside. And then what that made me do is like, oh, I want to go to different states in my own country. You know, I want to go travel some other places. First time going to New York, you know, after I went to Sweden. And New York was like a whole different, I was like, yeah, this is a lot going on, you know. But it helped me to get out of that comfort zone of just being in my own town, my own area.
Let's talk about the flight, because a lot of times, you know, when we talk about traveling, we don't know. Now, a lot of my people who follow me have traveled extensively. I think, to be honest, I have a great deal of black men who have middle class incomes. Like, I know, like, for example, Doug, who went to Hampton. Mm-hmm. Shout out to Doug. You know, I have a lot of black men who have either been in the military or have worked extensively or graduated. So they have, you know, means. Many have traveled. But for the brothers who have not traveled out of the country, let's talk about, you know, where you laid over at going to Sweden. Remember how long it took you to get there. How did you adjust to the time difference? And then we'll talk about the women there later that you saw. But let's kind of go from there. Mm-hmm. You flew from Richmond into where?
I went from Richmond to JFK, and then I went to Reykjavik, Iceland. Mm-hmm. And then after from Iceland, we went to Stockholm.
Stockholm. How long was the flight to Iceland?
That show was long. That show was so long. It had to be like altogether like 12 something hours.
Okay. The whole thing. When you got there, I'm pretty sure to Sweden, you realized that your plug outlets didn't work, right?
I prepared, man. Like, I had brought like all the outlets and stuff, so I was good.
All the outlets. let's talk about, you know, you having to exchange currency. I don't know if Swedish uses like some sort of a krona. Mm-hmm. You know, do they use the krona krona? Okay, because I know Norway uses a krona, Danish krona. Okay, so you had to, you know, currency exchange. How hard was it for you to get used to how much things cost there, you know, seeing different kind of currency, seeing different money?
I Googled it, man. I had went to Stockholm. I stayed at, like, the hotel out there. I forgot the name. It was, like, a real long name. But I used my PayPal debit card the whole time. And so, mm-hmm. Man, PayPal, you can use that thing anywhere. That joint works anywhere.
Damn, I didn't even know that.
Yep, PayPal. And it's no, you know, the bank won't put a restriction on it. You don't got to call the bank, let you know you're going to be out of town. It just works.
Fuck. Okay. So shit, I didn't even know that. All right. So you know, let me talk. Let me I guess build on this. Okay. So you go to Sweden. Hold on a second. I think is how is heel, Shay? I think High Def is asking the question. I don't understand that question. High Def, can you reformat that so I can ask him what you want me to say? So let me ask you this. So you get to Sweden. Now did you? I'm not saying you was out there, you know, fucking on Swedish girls or something, but. I mean, that's for, we will keep that offline, you know, a little something. But, you know, what was the experience that you saw? Like, what was different from, like, Swedish women that maybe women that you saw in America? You know, if you go into the malls and stuff, the people, what was so different about Sweden than America, in your opinion?
Oh, the people were just more open. They were more open to different types of music because most of the people have never heard of me there until I performed. Mm-hmm. And they were just more open to it, man. They were like, it was like a genuine appreciation for music. You know, I'm not on the Billboard charts. You know, I don't have multiple Grammys or anything. But they just appreciate the music. It's not about how popular you are. It's like, do you have a major effect on my life? Are you changing? Are you giving me something right now that can help me? And that's the vibe I got from it. You know, they didn't say like, oh, you're a black man, play a violin. They said, oh, whoa, you're a great violinist. You know, it was just more open. And it's the first time I understood, like, they had like a formal dress code for the event. And so I came with the suit, man. People were dressed down. Like, their formal over there is very, like, relaxed. That's like a you know, collared shirt and some slacks. You know what I mean? No tie. That's formal in Sweden.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, what, you know, shout out to Kevin Samuels that's in the chat there. Appreciate him for the interview that he came out last night also. Let me do this because we're talking about what we are doing here. Then you went from Sweden. Where was the next overseas place that you went to?
The next one was London, and also Birmingham. So I was in that area for almost a week and a half, and. Over there in Birmingham, like, their squirrels are basically, squirrels here in the States are basically like rabbits over there. They have rabbits hopping all over the place. So that shocked me at first. I was like, oh, what's all these rabbits all over the place? But that's normal there. They're like squirrels. Mm-hmm. And but what was cool, particular area I was in, there was nothing but Ferraris, Maybachs, and they were like normal cars there. And I was like, yeah, this is very interesting. Because I've definitely never seen it before. I'm used to it.
Let me ask you this, because, you know, I've never been to London yet, but I did come back from Uganda. Shout out to Uganda. It was a British colony. And one of the first things that I noticed is just like London, people drive on the right side of the road and the driver's side is on the right side. Did you notice that?
Yeah, that threw me off. That threw me off. Yeah, that really threw me off. That was very interesting. I don't know that took me a while to get used to.
What did you think of you know, London as a city? How did you feel?
I mean, London was it reminded me a lot like New York, except more relaxed.
More relaxed.
A little bit more relaxed. But it still had like a lot of similarities to New York City, but it still was a lot different for me. It's just a different environment. I'm not in my natural state, right? And so really it was awkward for me, just walking around. I just still didn't feel comfortable. I had a lot of anxiety the first few times I traveled, but the more I started to travel, the easier it got. You know, the easier it was to, you know, to talk to people and just have conversation. Yeah, I noticed that people just don't care, like, if you're black. They're like, yo, what are you doing? That's it. You know what I mean? And I noticed that over here, it's a big pressure for a lot of young black men, man. They feel like they can't rise above their struggles. And until I started see I so I started traveling, man, I started to my mind just opened up. I was like, yo, I can do a lot with this. I can do a lot with music, violin. I don't have to just be in the orchestra. I don't have to be a teacher. I can do other stuff rather than the conventional route that I was going through college at that time.
Okay. Let me ask you this, because I know you've been to other countries, but I want to talk about this, and this is going to probably go a little against the grain, but I'll play devil's advocate here for a little bit. In your opinion, what group of women, Nick, I know you had a black girlfriend before, and the most black men like myself and you, a lot of educated, collegiately approved black men do date black women. I mean, because the numbers bear it out, but there is a good, a sizable chunk of black men who get a lot of attention from another group of women who happen to be not black. In your experience, what group of women have shown you more interest as far as dating and romance? Since you've been playing the violin.
I would say mostly white women have given like the most like they've been pursuing me the most. And I think, naturally I was very close-minded. That was like I only date black women, and I started to see myself open up. And so I travel so much, man. I had to get out of this box mentality of, you can only stay in your you're only supposed to stay in your own hometown. You're not supposed to go anywhere else. And I started to see like, yo, like there's so many more options out here. And when I started to perform and travel more, what I started to see was that pursuing women full time is just like I started to not practice as much. I didn't work on myself anymore. And so I had to really realize that like, yo, like I can't just be out here just chasing after women all day. And what that did was they hit me up all the time. They send me DMs. They're like, oh, that guy, I just want to hang out with you because your energy is positive. And now I have the option to pick and choose who I want to allow in my life. Like, because that energy is real. You have a negative woman, you're going to have a negative life.
Say it again.
If you have a negative woman, you're going to have a negative life.
Let me ask you this, because I mean, a lot of people probably will never have some of the notoriety that you have or some of the fame that you do have. But let's talk about one thing. How much easier did it get for you to?
I'll see where you go. Oh,
Stop it, Brandon Jones. I don't know if you know about Brandon Jones, my boy, right there. His brother is Chris Jones, who has the physiques of fitness, also known as Pump Chasers. Have you ever heard that channel before? Pump Chasers?
mm-mm.
Yeah, you gotta check him out, dude. He's hilarious, man. He's a bodybuilder, like over like 50 million channel views and like 400,000 subscribers, man. Love to introduce you to him. He talks about his his success as a millionaire bodybuilder now and how the women just came through. But I want to know about you, man. Like when you started to blow up, when did you start to see the chicks coming around and you was able to
Well, at first, I saw myself, because like all through growing up, man, I really was dedicated to music and violin, so I didn't have a lot of time, you know what I mean, to be out here dating. And really, I was just so grinding so hard with music. But when I got to college, I was automatically a superstar on campus. So, and I was living in the athletic dorms with the other athletes. They treated me like an athlete pretty much. I didn't have to do anything. All I got to say is, yo, I play violin, I do music, and they automatically were interested. I was like, oh, okay. But then as I started to continue, I started to realize, like, this is, you know, when you have a lot of influence, you have to treat it with care. You can't be out here just doing whatever. Influence is powerful. You know, you can, when you have influence, you can persuade people to do things. You know, they'll listen to you. And if you don't treat that with care and continue to grow with that, and you use that influence to be like, oh, I'm just going to get some girls, or I'm just going to, you're going to end up unfulfilled. You will end up unfulfilled because it's never going to be enough. It's always going to be a woman who looks better. And until you're satisfied with yourself, you know, you continue growing. That is the focus, guys. I want you guys to remember that's the focus. Oh, what's up, 804? 804 in here, deep. Whoa. 804. Virginia's in here. That's the focus, man. Like, it's never been a problem for me getting women when I started to become famous for music. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't take a lot of work. I started to see, like, oh, once you get the girls, it's like, okay, this is cool. What's next?
And wait, Say it again.
Once you get a guy can get enough women, like, it becomes like, okay, what's next? And I, when I got all the women I wanted, I was broken. You know, I was broken. It's like I realized, like, this is not what I wanted. This is going against my own beliefs. Like, this is a pointless endeavor. And I started to realize, you know, I can use my influence to inspire people to be better than they were yesterday. It's a shift of focus. And so it just didn't matter so much anymore. Now I get DMs all day long, emails and stuff. It's just, I don't even answer DMs anymore. It's got so ridiculous.
From girls?
Yes, I don't answer it. I don't answer those because I'm so focused. I got laser-like focus. I'm focused on what I got to do. Mm-hmm. That stuff will come later. I'll have time for that. But right now, I'm 26. I still got work to do. Still got more foundation to lay.
Mm-hmm. So you're on Instagram, right?
Yeah.
How many people, followers, do you have on Instagram?
I think it's like 18,000.
Okay, let me talk about this, because Instagram... Okay, like, I don't usually really fuck with Instagram, but all the bitches on Instagram. I mean, I mean, most dudes, because Instagram is really for, I think, two sets of people. Hoes.
Mm-hmm.
Or women. Hoes, because hoes and women is the same. You know, hoes is a subcategory of women. Models.
Mm-hmm.
Magazines promoting. More hoes are some sorts of women. And, you know, athletes, comedians, entertainers, artists like you.
Mm-hmm.
The average dude like me on Instagram with like 10 followers in. You know, we ain't experiencing, you know, chicks trying to, most average brothers on social media, ain't no chicks in our inbox. Ain't nobody sending us no booty pictures or, hey, you know, they just not, you know what I mean? Even I'm a YouTuber. And I'm, you know, 38,000 subscribers on my main channel. Chicks don't even hit me up on YouTube. But to be able to have a big, you're a guy that can experience, you know, you have chicks wanting to throw the pussy at you. Most dudes will never experience that shit. You understand that, right?
Oh, yeah, I get it.
Because you was at a time where you wouldn't get no ass. I'm pretty sure you was.
I could tell, and I understand from a guy's point of view who is, probably still a virgin, has never been with a woman. I can understand that. But I'm telling you guys out there that your focus has to be towards your purpose. Because let's say you do get a woman, you don't know what you're doing with your life. So she's going to be led astray also. She's going to be just lost.
Wait.
Y'all both are going to be lost.
Oh, shit.
She's trying, a woman needs to follow a man. Like, if he's out here and he doesn't know what he's doing with his life, he's going to be lost. He will. I've been there. And so it might look cool. It might look cool. Like, oh, you know, if you're a celebrity, you can do whatever you want. You know, you can get any girl in the DM, which is cool. They do pay attention.
Mm-hmm.
They do pay attention. But I know now it's not enough. Because I've been in that position. Mm-hmm. I get it. You're going to end up going from woman to woman until you're going to feel like, oh, once I get that girl, then I'll be straight.
Mm-hmm.
Once I get this promotion, I'll be straight. Once I get that, it's never going to be enough. You have to follow your purpose. And then you will be blessed. Your blessings will come. But if you're not ready, how can you be blessed? You can't be blessed if you're not ready, guys. I'm serious. Got to prepare yourself. That's O'Shea. Look, I had to prepare myself for when I make a lot of money, for when I have a lot of influence, and people are always watching me. I had to prepare myself. Otherwise, you crash and burn. Crash and burn.
That's astounding, man. I mean, I always talk about a lot of times, black men, you know, you're not ready for success because, you know, people don't understand me. You know, I can attest to this. I've had money before I started YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
In my little ghetto fam over here in the hood and YouTube. shout out to the ghetto black, the ghetto section of the, I call it, it ain't really the hood, I just call it the hood. That's what we got. You know, when you start having money, it can change things for the good or the bad.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of times, some people don't understand what it feels like to be able to, like, you know, and granted, you know, I'm just using myself, for example, I'll come back to you. Mm-hmm. You can pay your rent for a whole year and it don't bother you. You can write a check and pay your rent for a whole year. When you can go in the store, in any store, and there's nothing that you can't buy because you know you're going to have the money.
Yeah.
It's a good feeling. I now know that feeling. I've been knowing what that feels like for like the last 7 or 8 months, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That's crazy to feel like. But at the same time, a lot of people, if you've never had money before or managed money before,
mm-hmm.
you go crazy, you know? Now, I'm just talking about having money. Now, I'm living in Poland. I'm not in the United States and shit. People know me in the USA, probably. People don't know me in Poland. But you're getting money and bitches want to fuck you. You know, that's even double. Like, I mean, you know, the thing about it is a lot of niggas can't deal with that. Look at athletes, you know? Look at...
And they always get caught up in stupid situations. And I mean, that's one of the big things, man. Like, okay, a lot of people say they want to be famous and they want to have money, but why? Why do you want to be famous? Why do you want to have money?
Say it again.
Why do you want to be famous and why do you want to have money?
Mm-hmm.
Because to me, money is just an idea. It's a tool. Like, it's just a tool, comes and goes. Money doesn't make you rich. How you spend it does. And so you could give, I mean, y'all probably remember the Dave Chappelle skit, right? Where it's like, they're going to give reparations. They're going to give everybody mad money, right? For slavery.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're going to give everybody money. What did people do in that Dave Chappelle skit? They just blew it. And it went back to the same hands of the people who had it before.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the way when I quit my job, I started thinking about money differently. It's like, I already knew I couldn't make any substantial amount of money at my job. what I needed to do, the people I wanted to affect, places I wanted to go. I couldn't do it at that job. It was comfortable, but it's, I know I needed more to get there. And so I want to encourage you guys, like, you guys are probably like, you know, once I get this car, I'll be straight. You know what I mean? Like, once I move out of my parents' house, or everybody's got something that they, you know, they feel like once they get, then they'll be straight. No, it's not true. You can start right now. You have to prepare yourself to be blessed. God's not going to bless you if you're not ready. You're not ready for the blessing. So if you get it, then you just like, you're not going to know how to handle it. That's why you see a lot of celebrities out here killing themselves, stuck on heroin. You know, they're just completely lost. They just look like they're out of it. If you know what I mean. You're going to see that because they're not ready for it. A lot of people want to be famous. A lot of people want to be successful. But you got to prepare, guys. And the first part we talked about earlier is get yourself a journal, something where you can write down your goals.
Some of the things that I've said. Let me ask you this. You came across some of my videos, and I don't know if this is the same Brandon Jones. One of the Brandon Jones in here is either Chris Jones' brother or your boy Brandon Jones.
It's probably my boy Brandon Jones.
All right, yeah. Shout out to Brandon Jones. What video of mine did he introduce you? Because I got a lot of, you know,
It was one of the videos about simping. But it was one of the videos where I think it was, you recently made it, where, you know, women take advantage of guys who do this, who simp like this or something like that. Mm-hmm. I remember watching that and I was just like, wow, I know this video is probably helping a lot of people right now. Mm-hmm. And so I went and watched some other ones and I was like, yo, this dude's onto something. We're kind of on the same page, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's a relatability, man, because it's like he's talking to me, you know, like a young brother who's constantly trying to improve, he's always taking things from other people. He's always learning, you know, and I could relate to that because there are many times in the past where I would just lose focus. You know, I'd be totally like, I would stop playing violin. You know, I feel like, I'm not good enough. You know, I'm never going to be good. You know, I'm never going to get out of this situation. And your videos help people get out of those situations. Because for young black men, the majority of the situations they get in are with women that they don't need to be with. they need to be working on themselves. And then the higher quality of women will come into your life who are positive, who have values. You know what I mean? They're not exposing themselves on Instagram. You know, they care about themselves, you know, and it's almost like self-respect. You got to have, if your woman is out there and she's not respecting herself, then that reflects you too. You know, and it's actually, in my life, man, your videos have just watching those three videos, bro. I watched them back to back. Me and my boy, me and Brandon, we went up to New York City to visit the Twitter offices, see some of the employees and stuff. And I listened to your videos on the way up there. And I was just like, yo, this dude's really on to something. He's got something good right here.
And you know what's so funny, man? I got 700 other videos you've never probably seen.
Yep.
That I just unlocked. Shout out to everybody that asked me for my classics where I was really dropping some crazy shit last years ago. I have like 631 videos on private. So
wow.
Yeah, man. I got some shit for your ass. So, you know, you probably haven't even seen all the ones on this channel. So if you want to binge on some of my old school 500, 600,000 views videos, man, You can see that. But I appreciate you coming, man. Let's talk about what's next, because I know that you are currently on tour right now. You have a SoundCloud. Let's talk about this tour. I know that you were, you know, in Norwalk in April. You're in Richmond. You're in Atlanta the next day. Chicago. You're in New York. You just came back from San Antonio, right?
I'm going to San Antonio.
July. Okay, is your first time going there?
Second time.
Second time. Let's talk about San Antonio real quick. What did you like about San Antonio?
So San Antonio is very arts, art center. I performed at the Tobin Center last time, the Carlos Alvarez Theater. That's the part of the Tobin Center. It's a little bit, a little bit smaller than the, you know, like the big part. It's like a small studio, holds about 300 people. Last time I was there was last year in April. And that was my first show just by myself, you know, outside of Virginia. And I remember the feeling when I was on the plane going there. I was like, man, I don't know if anybody's going to show up. You know, what if there's like 10 people there? What if nobody shows up, you know? Am I worthy of coming to the state and performing for these people? And I just pushed through. I kept going. I didn't cancel the show. I kept going. And what do you know? 300 people came and it sold out.
Damn.
That made me think. I was like, whoa. No promotion, no radio, no press.
Wow.
Nothing. And so that made me think. I was like, okay, I should do a tour. And so I wrote it down. And I started getting my analytics together for all my social media, Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, everything. And I started to see where everybody else was. Like, what other cities, what other states are people in? And, you know, first I got excited. I was like, oh, I'm going to do a world tour. I want to go everywhere. But I was like, nah, I got to go in steps. It's levels to this. And I just scheduled another tour, which is one I'm on right now. I scheduled this last year. I started planning, looking at venues, started saving up money, and I booked it. Booked the shows, you know, and took a leap, spent money on it. And now it's like I'm reaping the benefits from last year. You know, the money, it hurt spending it on those venues. But now I get it, because it's like, what if I was so scared? You know, I was scared. I was comfortable in my job. I was like, nah, I'm not going to do it. And then people at my old job, they were like, I was like, yo, I'm going to go on tour next year. You know, I'm leaving this job. And they were like, that's why I say, don't tell your goals. Mm-hmm. They were like, oh, well, you know, your job is always going to be here. You'll be back, right? And I was like, no, I'm not coming back. And I just remember them. They kept saying, like, oh, yeah, well, the job's here. Everybody goes on tour, comes back. I was like, whoa, that's real negative. And I left that job. And I know a young brother asked me, he was like, what made you leave the job? I just wanted to leave. It was no, like, calculation, no planning. I gave my 2 weeks notice. It was out. It was gone. Mm-hmm. And once I started to see that Tobin Center, I sold that out, 300 people, I was like, all right, I'm gonna start small with this. I'm gonna do this in other cities. So I had to know where my people are, what cities where most people are from. So I calculated that data and I looked at where I should go. So for Facebook, it only does analytics by 28 days increments. So I calculated for 6 months. Added it all together, and it gave me an idea where people are from. Mm-hmm. That's why, like, Norwalk, that show sold out. Obviously Richmond, it sold out. That's why, like, these places are successful, because I wrote down, like, where everybody's from. Mm-hmm. I studied the areas, like, what's the most popular venue, where do people go, you know, especially Chicago. I mean, that's, some people stay in their own, like, you know, parts, you know, they don't leave out of there.
Right.
See a south side, do the north side.
Wow. Okay. Let me do this, man, because How long is the stream going? But we were rocking for about an hour or so. And you know, I want to do a part two to this, man, because you know, you dropped so many. I think Poker has been counting. And the thing about it is, they want you to play something, but I don't want you to play something right now. I want them these niggas to wait. Right, because you gave them a little some. Because I want them to come back next time. I want people to see this video and let people be inspired by it. And I know you're a busy person, but can you come back next Sunday?
Yes.
Okay, we'll do a part two to this. Now, shout out. Let's see, my man Kevin Samuels. Now, let me kind of address something real quick, because Kevin made a point about different YouTubers who stream at different times, like within Black YouTube. Here's my response to that and other Black YouTubers who are like that, who have this kind of maybe think on this narrative. The live shows. People put a lot of the way the YouTube analytics work is not so much about people that are on live. Like, for example, if I see Angry Man is live or Minister Jap is live, because we all kind of like are running in the same tight circle, I probably won't stream at the same time as Minister Jap. Or sometimes Jap will come on and just stream even if I'm streaming. Now, if I have like a dedicated interview, then I won't stream. But like people like me, let's say Jada Black. Other Black male YouTubers, maybe like Jay Miller Speaks Out. The real truth is that, like with YouTubers, a lot of YouTubers, people like certain YouTubers and hate others. There are a lot of people who hate me, right? But they may like Jada Black. Like a lot of people may like Jada Black, but not like, you know, let's say certain other people, right? The only group of YouTubers that I found that we all have the same fans for the most part, me, Angry Man, and Minister Jap. Those are the only three. Me, because me, Angry Man, and Minister Jap work like together for extensively like the last 13 months. So all of us have the same core audience. That's why if Angry Man is doing a show, I'm pretty much not doing a show. If Minister Jap is doing a show, I'm not doing the show for the most part, because our fans, like 90% of the time, you don't subscribe to Minister Jap without subscribing to me or to Angry Man. That's just because that's how it rocks. That's how the analytics prove it. Anybody else outside of that, for the most part, you know, Jada Black, you know, Tommy, other Black YouTubers, you know, it's a little different. So I know Kevin will be streaming tonight. From, I believe, let me see his time and give him a shout out. He will be doing some styling and consulting. So we will try to support his show tonight. I was supposed to do a show, a big panel. I don't know if I'm going to do it, but he will be on. Let me just do this. He will be on tonight from 7:30, I think, Central Standard Time. If I'm not mistaken, let me see here. Let me just go on here. Hold on. Okay, 9:30 Central Standard. Sorry, my bad. 9:30 Central Standard Time. So that would be like 10:30 Eastern Standard Time, 7:30 Pacific Standard Time. So if you want to check out the styling show Kevin Samuels has tonight, you can do that. So I might stream a little before that, but I'll try to not interfere. And just off of this particular request, I know he only streams like twice a week. If you're also a YouTuber that I work with, and you have like a certain day that you would want, you know, maybe to get more of my audience over there, I'll help you with that. I know he only streams like maybe once or twice a week. So, but in general, you know, as far as the fan bases that really I don't stream at the time is like me, Jap, and Angry Man. Like I said, the Camino, we're part of this YouTube commission for the most part. So I don't, you know, we all kind of really have the same people. All right. So once again, Eric, any closing things you want to say? Man, you did a great interview, bro. A lot of people are now going to be more knowing about you. What else would you like to say to in this?
All right. So, guys, if there's anything in your life right now that you know is not helping you, I want you to get rid of it right now. Be realistic. Be realistic about this. Maybe it's that the girlfriend that you know is not helping you in any way. She's actually tearing you down. Maybe it's that job that you feel like you need to quit. You've been thinking about it for like a year. Anything, man, like get it out your life, because what that allows is allows for greater things to come into your life. And it allows for those blessings to come into your life and manifest. And I just want to encourage you guys to get inspired and stay inspired. I say that everywhere. I put that all over the internet. Stay inspired, guys. You got this.
Much wisdom from, I have to say, he's on the road to being a Jedi master. you know, brother, I really appreciate you reaching, you know, I knew you were somebody when I saw like the particular, like you said, oh man, traveling changed me. I was like, who is this nigga? I was like, oh shit. Never just go in on hella people. I was like, nigga, who are you? I was, oh, it's him. So, you know, man, I think a lot of people, man, have built a lot of respect for you because they've seen you around so much. And you know, we really are rooting for you, man, because a lot of brothers is not, you know, damn sure ain't.
Yeah, man, it's like respect, man. Like respect and attention, they're not the same. That's something I realized because people come up. I was in Chicago last week. I'm walking through the airport. Four people came up to me. You know, some people haven't seen my videos in like 5 years, but I had an impact on them.
Damn, really?
Respect over attention. Don't chase. Do not chase attention, guys. It's respect. It's way greater impact on people. Because anybody can get attention. I can do something stupid and get a million views in a few minutes. You know, it's like, well, attention doesn't last, but respect does.
Perfectly said, brother. Really appreciate you, man. Let's link up and work next week if we can. You guys,
I think this is a good time. Five is good.
Five. Okay, yeah, we'll work five. Let me do. Yeah, hell yeah, it's hot in here. Shit, let me tell you guys. you know, I don't want to be on here showing on my muscles or nothing. You know, because you know, I don't want to take them new niggas, women or nothing like that. You know what I'm saying?
You got a sweater. You got the sweater joint going too.
Yeah, and I got it all.
It's all zipped up.
I was trying to do it cool, man, but these niggas, man, had me mad and shit. You know, I'm sorry for the out. No, I don't apologize for my outburst. That's what I do. Fuck that. That's me. I know how to give a good interview, but at the same time, if you niggas come here talking that bullshit, I'm gonna check you. All right, so let you know, I'm glad that he came on, fam, and you know, we gonna rock again. And so thank you for introducing us, you know, for the most part, to, you know, your music. Actually, I want to do this. I'd like to get an article, an interview, not just on this, but maybe on the Negro Manosphere. You know, we want to start putting more you know, stuff like that. So we'll do that because, you know, I also have a website that we talk about black males issues. He said, I thought you were leaving.
Poker.
Yeah. Yo,
hey, but look, the stuff I be putting out on social media, man, people be sharing it.
He said, I'm going to get 2,000.
Look, I'm be serious. Okay, so I started sharing my thoughts, right, because I only used to just play violin. I started sharing my thoughts on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. And my Facebook jumped like 200,000 people in a month.
Damn!
Just from sharing the stuff I had in my mind. Like, I would just post videos and just play about, and that's it. But now I'm trying to like go and like give people some insight on how I push through as a musician, you know, or I think I can give people some, you know, some keys. Yeah, man. I just want to encourage you. Thanks for watching, guys, man. You know, thanks for supporting O'Shea. You know what I'm saying? As a Black community, it's important for us to not only stick together, but to encourage each other and not have the crab in the barrel mindset.
Yeah, man. That's absolutely correct. I try to do that. I'm a little ghetto. I'm really a little ghetto, man. But what I will say is I definitely believe in practicing what you preach. You know, I believe in trying to give Black men a platform, working with brothers, you know, like people like Kevin Samuels, you know, you. And I'll tell you like this, man, since I've been working with brothers, you know, Black men have a lot of fucking potential, but a lot of people don't really believe in Black men. They don't.
Yeah.
No, they don't, man. And the reason why people don't believe in us is because you niggas don't believe in us. That's just what it is. I ain't talking about y'all particularly, but this is the thing. Yeah. You know, a lot of Black men are talented. You know, a lot of people don't want to give Black men credit for what they can do.
Yeah.
And then you got to come on, you know, and there's no outlet that's trying to tell people what Black men can do. A lot of people don't like that. You know, I'm just going to keep it real.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't like the fact that Black men can do certain things and many times in cases better or as well as other races of men. And the thing about it is, if you Black men want respect, it starts with respecting others. It starts with not having that bullshit ass crap in the barrel mentality. I'm not jealous of no Black men, man. That's all I work with. You guys see, my life has changed, man. Working with brothers. Let me tell you something before we leave. Kevin Samuel, I talked to him offline. He said, man, it's astonishing that your audience is 98% Black and you are financially supported by just those people.
Yep.
And the reason why my audience and I can do some of the things that I'm doing is because I work with brothers. Eric Stanley is trying to work with brothers. You know what I mean? High def, you know, he's a little light-skinned. You know, that's all right. But he worked with brothers. You know what I mean? the thing is, you cannot expect to, get far, you know, to be respected as a group of men. All other groups of men understand that if, you know, they help each other, they're gonna be successful. For example, before we leave, there's a brother named Sirius. If you guys heard him on the show, I had a debate with the Flat Earth people. Yeah, Sirius is an asshole. Let me keep it real. If you guys heard Sirius, I think the Ron was on the Flat Earth debate we had. Sirius has I never met a person that had a talent for being an asshole. If you, who does that, right? But I'm just telling you, he has an idea where we're going to have a Young Turks news show like it's going to be for Black men, but we're going to have it on his channel. Now, the thing about it is he has the capability to create the channel. Now, most of us will be like, well, how much money am I going to get out of it? I said, brother, start the account, start the channel. You take all the money for it. As long as it benefits the Black male community. See, a lot of we don't think like that. And pretty soon, Black men, we're going to have a network TV show that's just like Alex Jones or the Young Turks. And yep. See, the thing about it is it can't happen if you got too many egos.
Woo!
Let's think about how Eric is, right? He got way more fans than me. He got, you know, way more success than me. I'm not going on O'Shea's little YouTube channel. Who fuck that nigga? I'm Eric motherfucking Stanley. I'm motherfucking Eric Stanley with the flat top. Nigga, I'm not going on that nigga's show. I'm motherfucking Eric Stanley. See?
I'll show you why. I mean, my mindset, man, with that, I would be in, like, studios and stuff, like, you know, like celebrities. And people will always gravitate towards the celebrities. You understand what I mean? Like, they be trying to get their information, trying to spit for them, trying to give them beats and all this stuff. And I was starting to see, like, yo, these people come in the studio, they ignore everybody else. What is up with that? And so what you'll see a lot of times in the music industry, people will lose because they are trying to focus at the people who are already at the top, you know, in terms of accolades and stuff. like they see them as higher than this other person, and they miss out on the people who are going to be big. Mm-hmm. The guy in the corner of the room just kind of just sitting there, you know, just not really doing much. He doesn't look like he's, you know, doing a lot. But people miss out on the people who are rising. They don't want to support anybody because they feel like, oh, if I support them, I'm going to lose. You're not going to lose. You know how many people are on the internet? Come on, guys. Y'all know how many people are on the internet out here? It's not going to hurt you to support somebody else, to share somebody's video, to give it a like, to anything, man. It doesn't hurt you to support somebody else. And I would really encourage you guys to support somebody, because I know somebody up here does music. I know somebody up here does music right now. You're probably wondering why you're not getting anywhere and why nobody in your hometown supports you. But I ask you this question: who have you supported in your hometown? What show have you gone to? Because my last show in Richmond, I only knew 10 people there.
Damn, that means a lot of people that you
didn't come. My friends didn't show up. I didn't know these people. My friends didn't show up to my own show, my own tour show in my hometown. Didn't know these people. But doesn't mean I stopped supporting people. And it's hard. That's a hard lesson to learn, because you feel like if nobody supports you, I'm not going to support anybody. Shoot, I've been hurt, man, because I don't need to support nobody. Anybody going to support me? I'm just going to grind by myself and struggle.
Yeah, a lot of brothers do that, man. And we got to get out of that mindset. And see, his brothers like Eric, you know, I'm a little bit more bio with it. He's a little bit more nice to me. Brothers like me, we're trying to, you know, change that. We really want to see you black men do well, man. That's really what we're trying to do. You know, we could be doing, trust me, man, I'll tell you like this. The white man got a lot of money for people who just want to just be on his agenda. You know, it's not popular, man, with, you know, people when you're trying to do stuff for black people. It's not popular. You got to understand that. You know, when you decide that you want to help black people, it's not a popular thing. When you want to do something for black people, it's not a popular thing. So a lot of black people put themselves at risk just by wanting to help their own folks. You know, but at the end of the day, we got to get out of that and stay out of that. And we have our talented people like Eric, you know, that's out there doing something different and being successful at it. We got to throw our support around him, because as he, you know, he's one of our leaders. We don't want to look at it like that, but it is. You know, when we have a black man that's doing something different in the field, he represents us people. Those are people who are opening doors for the rest of people. Mm-hmm. He's a builder of the black community, you know, and we got to really throw our support around brothers like this. Buy the CDs. Matter of fact, I'm going to buy whatever kind of CDs you got. If you have any album, we're going to start set. You niggas going to start buying it. Hold on. Do you got anything for sale?
Yeah, I got stuff on Amazon.
Okay, I'm about to buy that shit right. Where is Amazon? Let me tell you something. Where can we find it? I know you didn't come on here to sell some shit, but we're going to buy it.
It's called the Eric Stanley EP.
The Eric Stanley EP.
Mm-hmm. I got stuff on SoundCloud, too. Hoping the stuff on SoundCloud.
Let me get it right now. Get this shit. Boom! $10.89. Get 2 days shipping. Wait, can I? Okay, I'll get a 3 days shipping. Okay, and let me see here. No, I don't want that. Hold on a second. Let me do this right now. Oh, I got 11 items. What the hell? You're trying to get me to do some shit on Amazon. I mean, actually, let me see here. How much? Let's see here. Okay, hold on. Let me do this. Edit cart. How the hell do you edit cart? I believe in a couple of brothers. Hold on a second. Let me do this.
Oh, I messed that link all up.
Let me see. Hold on a second. I'm going to order this right now.
Oh, Chris, it's Eastend 247.
Yeah, and shout out to your Change. Okay. Zero. I don't want that shit. They're trying to sell me hella pins. I don't want to buy them pins. Okay. I want to buy this. Okay. Place your order. It's $10.89. All right. So it's $11.79. I just bought the album. Yeah. Just now. Okay.
Appreciate it, bro.
So, you know, and then the next time that I come on here, all right, I want 10 brothers the next time to buy Eric Stanley's album. And the reason why I'm telling you to buy it is because if you don't buy it, you can't expect nobody else to buy your shit either. Yeah. This is the thing. You know, black men, we have to start doing business with each other. If we want to see, you know, your black studios, recording studios, stuff like that, you want to see, you know, black men not with their pants hanging down, looking like assholes and shit on the streets. You know, you can't expect that if you're not going to support a brother who ain't out there doing that. If you want people to have a better representation of you, you got to start supporting the people who are representing you in the right motherfucking way, you know? Yeah. So I just bought the album, man. Actually, I was going to go for my mom because I'm in Poland. Because if they ship it over here, I never get it. But
oh, yeah.
Next time, we're going to go ahead and try to get these sales up for you, fam. We'll let you know that we support you and we love you. We can get these sales up. I know you wasn't even asking for that. But we just try to bless you with that, fam. And appreciate you, man. Anything else you want to say?
Oh, no, man. I just hope everybody got something from this, man. We're going to be back next week, Sunday at 5 p.m. Eastern time. What's the translation for that?
Oh, in Poland? Late as hell. Yeah. Like 11. But, it ain't nothing. We be rocking. So we be rocking. All right, man. So we'll see you back then, man. Thank you for coming on. And we'll chop it up later. Now, you guys, I do have another hangout that's probably going to be a big hangout on my main channel, about 30 minutes, and then I'll try to lead that hangout into help Kevin Samuels out because he has a hangout at 9:30 Central Time. So I'll try to push my hangout into his hangout so he can get some more traffic. All right, brother, so thank you so much. Appreciate you guys, man. Much love, Eric, man, and we will see you soon.
Peace.
Peace.